It's been a hot minute since I've done this. And by this, I mean a time-lapse drawing where I just sit down and talk to you. I don't mean make a video in general, although that is somewhat true. So, I could just sit here and list all the reasons that have kept me from getting videos out sooner, but I think the real blame here is the fact that it's 2018 and there is still no way to just pause time whenever you feel like it. If I could just pause time for as long as I wanted and work on a video, I'd have them out every day. You all would be drowning in content. But no, even in this day and age when we can clone animals and intimate relationships are being replaced with pictures of cartoon characters on pillows, we still can't do something as simple as pause time. Heck, there's still somehow no better way to floss your teeth than with a piece of string. It's so barbaric. Honestly, I'd be happy if we just made sleeping obsolete. Just think about how much more you could get done in those 7 or 8 hours you would usually spend doing literally nothing. Whenever I suggest this idea to someone, they always say, "But I love sleeping, it feels so good." The thing is, it wouldn't feel good if you didn't need to do it. Your body just gets tired, so it's relieving to lay down and sleep. But what if your body's energy was solely dependent on food consumption? As long as you ate a good meal, you'd feel fine and perfectly awake, and there would be no physiological need to sleep. Not to mention, eating takes a lot less time out of your day than sleeping. With those extra 8 hours, your productivity would skyrocket 33%. That's like 33% more studying, or 33% more taxes done, or even 33% more time spent wasting away watching anime. The possibilities are endless. Scientists haven't even figured out exactly why people need sleep. A lot of it is still a mystery, and if you can't explain the function behind something, then it's obviously useless. On another note, you might be wondering why there is an overlay of an old TV screen around the time-lapse. That is because I accidentally recorded the drawing in a smaller resolution than the usual 1920x1080. What happened is when I stream on Twitch, I put the maximum output resolution to be 1600x900. This is because it takes more bandwidth to stream at the typical 1920x1080. So, I settle for a happy medium that's still higher quality than 1280x720. But apparently, if I adjust my stream output to be 1600x900, it also changes my screen recording output to be the same resolution, since I use the same software to do both. So, I was left with a bunch of lower resolution recordings, and I'm not going to just resize them because that would look blurry and bad. Instead, I just decided to make a classy overlay, so it seems like it was on purpose. Wink wink. So, let's just all pretend that it was intentional, and that you like the aesthetic feel that it provides. Total, this drawing took me about 40 hours to make. What's funny is that 2 months ago, in August, I was about to head out for a week-long trip to California, and I thought I could grind out this whole drawing and the video before I left in a week. Looking back, that's absolutely hilarious. The thing was, I didn't plan on making the drawing as detailed as it turned out. My mistake was that I made the canvas an extremely high resolution, like 15,000 pixels wide or something, so it ended up being really detailed. I've had problems in the past, like in my high school art classes, when I would commit myself to art projects that I probably didn't have the time for. So, more times than not, I would end up going to the art room during study hall or after school to work on my stuff. I used to think it was because I was slow, but it turns out I just put a lot more effort into my projects than most of the other students. Pretty much the same thing happened with this drawing, but that's okay because I really like how it turned out. All that that means now is that I have to split this time-lapse into two separate videos and do a lot of talking. I'm even cutting out a lot of the process because some of it is very repetitive. Like, you don't need to see me draw each tentacle. You know what they say, once you've seen one tentacle drawn, you've seen them all. It's the same process each time, so I skip through a lot of that. A lot has happened since my last time-lapse drawing, so you'd think I'd have a lot to talk about. Unfortunately, I'm already struggling. I watch other people's time-lapse videos, and I don't understand how they always have something to talk about. I've seen some read stories, and I could always just go for the easy option and play nothing but music, but I'm not about to give up that easily. When I get desperate, I turn to Twitter. Someone suggested I talk about the tradition of stabbing and cutting gourds to scare children. First of all, I don't think any amateur pumpkin carvers would be able to make a pumpkin legitimately scary. Second of all, half the things people carve into pumpkins these days aren't supposed to be scary at all. A lot will print out templates and draw pictures of puppies or something, or just do a simple face. But me personally, I don't do any of those things. Last year, I just carved an anime face into my pumpkin. It looked amazing. I'm not sure how to handle trick-or-treaters now that I'm older and don't do trick-or-treating myself. Last year, one little girl showed up at our apartment. I wasn't there, but neither myself or my roommates expected this because our apartment was located in an area that's pretty much all college students. My brother answered the door, and he said he felt terrible because he didn't have anything to give her. If I were there, I would have given her some chicken Alfredo meal prep or something. Just heat it up on high for a minute and you've got a perfectly good lunch. That's a lot more useful than candy. But my brother felt bad about it, so he immediately rushed over to the store and bought a bag of candy. Nobody else showed up that night, leaving us with a big bag of Kit Kats to eat ourselves. The moral of the story is that even if you're too old to trick or treat, you're still a grown adult, so you can buy your own dang candy. Not only that, but you can buy nothing but candy you actually like. I can't tell you how many houses would give trash like pixie sticks when I went trick or treating. What people didn't understand is that I was planning on living off of that candy for like the next 2 months. It would be my main food source for survival. Pixie sticks are not sustainable. I needed that good nourishment, like chocolate bars, the stuff that actually fills you. Every year when I went trick-or-treating, there was always this one house in my neighborhood that put a lot more effort into scaring people than others. It was like the Test of Courage house, and they played dirty. They would open their garage and then cover the entrance with a big blanket like a curtain. So, you would walk in there, and it would be completely spooked out with the dark lighting, decorations, and everything. Sitting in a chair in the middle of the garage, they would have this thing that looked like a zombie with a bowl of candy in his lap. But for me as a child, it would be hard to tell if it was just a decoration or an actual guy in a zombie costume. If you wanted the candy, you had to muster up the courage to get it and end up possibly dying. Turns out, it was a guy in a zombie costume, and if you grabbed some candy, he would jump up and scream. It was terrifying. Another thing that has really changed about Halloween is that costumes seem to have to be a reference to some sort of popular media, or just like a clever joke of some kind. You don't see as many just like witches and ghosts or, oh, I'm a pumpkin anymore. When I was a kid, I would dress up as whatever combination of dark robe I could find in our costume bin, plus whatever plastic weapon was available and some sort of mask. And that was it, I was just like, spooky dark robe guy. Now you get a lot more video game characters, people from TV shows, and stuff like that. Not that those things were never around before, it's just gotten a lot more prevalent. This year, I think I'll be an anime character. But, you know, anime characters take a lot of effort to do, usually because it means some sort of highly specific and intricate clothing. I've developed a method that will enable me to perfectly mimic any anime character for about $20, and it's extremely low effort. I'm going to buy the body pillow cover of whatever character I decide on, and then just punch out some armholes. It's simple, yet extremely effective. You're not only wearing the exact same thing, but you also look exactly like them. I just have to be careful of one thing, and that's the other side of the body pillow. Most anime body pillows have two sides, one with the character in full clothing, then you flip it over and the character is in their underwear or just completely naked. It's for those times when you're lying in bed with the cartoon girl or guy of your dreams and things start to get steamy. But I can't go around potentially showing a naked anime character to everyone that looks at my back. So, I'll have to do some extremely careful shopping before dressing up as Hatsune Miku for Halloween. It's kind of weird if you think about it, how some pretty normal jobs are popular to dress up as for Halloween. Like a nurse, or a firefighter, or a policeman. I guess for kids it would be perfectly normal because a lot of the time they're dressing up as what they want to be when they grow up, so it's like they think it's cool. But there are still a lot of adults who dress up as those things. I suppose that adults usually do some sort of sexy version of whatever it is, though. like a sexy nurse or a sexy policeman. So if you have an actual job as a nurse and you go to a Halloween party where some chick is dressed up as a sexy nurse, would that be considered occupational appropriation? Are you allowed to get offended about that? I mean, they are degrading a serious life-saving job down to the level of a seductive Halloween costume. Maybe medical care workers should fight for the end of Halloween costumes that are disrespectful to their occupations. Personally, I think it's a legitimate social awareness issue. People will just have to start dressing up as occupations that are less serious, like a sexy McDonald's worker or something. That could become a thing, right?
Speaking of Halloween and October and stuff, it is currently Inktober. If anyone doesn't know what that is, the idea of Inktober is that you make an ink drawing every day of the month, during October, obviously. There's even an official daily Inktober prompt to give people some idea of what to draw. They don't have to be anything miraculous, even just a doodle, but I think it's developed because, you know, like, ink is black and stuff, so it's spooky or something. Personally, I think it's really good because not only does it encourage people to draw something every day for 31 days, it also encourages people to draw in ink. The thing about ink is that it's permanent, meaning it makes you really take care with the lines you draw. As a digital artist myself, I know it's easy to get lazy with your lines because you have the all-powerful Control-Z, which will immediately undo any mistakes you make. So it is good to draw in ink or do any kind of traditional art every now and again to keep up your touch. Unfortunately, I'm not doing Inktober. Don't got the time. I suppose I could draw something in class, but there are only two classes that are actually slow enough I can draw things and not pay attention. But even they sometimes actually require participation, which would make it tough. So I count this drawing as my Inktober. I think it fulfills the quota. I know it's not real ink, but it's still black, so close enough. Not to mention, it took about 40 hours to make, so if you divided that over the course of October, it would be more than an hour of drawing each day. That's my excuse, at least. So, a couple weeks ago, I was a witness to a very rare spectacle. It was a gathering of, well, douchebag trucks, for lack of a better word. It was about 9 at night, and I was in a parking lot to this strip mall going back to my car with my close female companion from a dinner. And this line of trucks just kept pouring into the lot and parking in a group. But they weren't just any trucks, they all had some sort of unnecessary modification, from oversized tires to lift kits to extra lights that didn't serve any purpose whatsoever. I was informed that they gather in groups just so that they can drive up and down the most populated street in the city, presumably to show off their extremely loud monstrosities. I know that there are people where I live who will drive up and down the street to show off their car, but I never heard of or witnessed them doing it in groups. And people having unnecessarily modified trucks isn't something that really bothers me. I mean, it's nothing new. That was fine. It was the fact that they felt the need to show them off in such a useless way. First of all, the street that they were going down was crowded enough. It didn't need any more traffic. There were people that actually had places to be, and some barricade of trucks would be terrible to be stuck behind. Second of all, it created so much unnecessary noise and air pollution. I just can't imagine what kind of person thinks so highly of themselves and the thing that they drive that they think other people want to see their trucks and feel the need to show them off in such a way. But then I told my brother about this, and he proposed a much more charitable view of the situation. Maybe it was a support group for men who were modestly hung, fun-sized, had compact peckers. They were there with other similarly impaired individuals as a means of finding solace and coping with their small packages. So, they gather with their trucks to show that they are big in another way, in things such as tire size and lift height. What a wonderfully supportive group of individuals. Something else new that has been happening recently is I've been getting a lot of emails from companies asking me to review their products. It really surprises me because I've only made 2 review videos, both of which are on drawing tablets. I've gotten a couple emails from other tablet companies, which is perfectly understandable and appropriate, But I've also gotten a lot of emails asking me to review products completely unrelated to anything I do on my channel. Usually they're for random electronic entertainment devices like Bluetooth earbuds or wireless chargers. I can kind of understand the connection between drawing tablets and other electronic devices, and why it would make a little sense for me to review something like that, but I'm still not a tech review channel. The most profound thing I could say about something like a wireless charger is, yeah, it worked good, or nah, it don't work so good. It's not like I'm able to provide specific insight of a certain product and compare it to other similar products in that price range like regular tech review channels. I don't have nearly enough experience with other electronics. But then there are people taking it to the next level and asking me to review products that have literally nothing to do with my channel. I've gotten emails asking me to make a video on things like facial cleansing kits, dog shock collars, and numerous random phone apps. They couldn't have picked more unrelated items if they tried. Is there anything about my channel that says beauty guru or qualifies me to review some sort of face wash kit in any way? It's like all these people saw was the word review in a couple of my videos and saw that I had a significant number of subscribers, so they thought it would be a good idea to ask me to review their product without actually watching any of my videos. For some reason, it feels a little bit insulting. I'm not sure why. I just feel like they want to use me. I mean, maybe the person that thought I'd review their dog shock collar was basing it off the fact that I had a dog in my last review video, but that was just to make it a little bit more interesting. The review video was still on a drawing tablet. At least they potentially actually watched one of my videos. The things I should be getting offers for are art supplies or even like protein supplements, because at least I made a video about working out. Not this other stuff where the companies clearly didn't watch a single video on my channel. I still find these sorts of emails pretty funny, not just because of the products that they want me to review, but because they all include smile emotes in the subject. If you go to the About section of my channel, which is where everyone goes to find my email, it says, "You can use my email for just about anything, just make sure to use a lot of smiley faces in the subject. It's very important." But I specifically request the kind of smiley face that you make with a colon and a right bracket. It looks like this. It's like a normal text smiley face, but it looks so much more stupid and has a lot more character. It's like a face that's so happy the sides of the mouth go up at a right degree angle. It's the superior text smiley face, much better than the standard colon right parentheses. So, I ask everyone that sends me an email to include these in the subject. I've gotten plenty of subscriber emails, including those, which makes me very happy, but it's always especially funny to see them from the spam emails. These are the people asking me to join their multi-channel networks or review their product, and it makes me giggle to see them include those smiley faces in the subject. It just means that they're willing to abandon any sense of professionalism in their email in order to appeal to me. It's very satisfying in a sadistic sort of way. If there are any representatives of multi-channel networks watching this video currently who are planning on emailing me, I still want you to include the smiley faces. If someone doesn't include them, it just makes me think that they don't care because they don't have the decency to conform to my simple request. In other news, I got to slap a baby the other day. Yes, that was a poorly worded statement on purpose, but also mostly accurate. The baby was a mannequin, and I was slapping it to practice relieving it if it were choking. I took a class a few days ago to get my basic life support certification, which was pretty interesting. I learned that the Heimlich maneuver equivalent for a baby is to grab their face, flip them over, and slap their back 5 times. Pretty brutal, right? Yeah, that was about the worst sounding description I could have given. I thought the class was pretty amusing because of the instructional videos that they used to give examples of what is done in situations where someone is either choking or going into cardiac arrest. The thing is, you can't really use an actor to fake receiving legitimate CPR. When you do chest compressions, you have to push the person's sternum down at least 2 inches, and a lot of the time that ends up breaking the ribcage. So in the videos, they would start out with a real-life actor who would go through the motions of going into cardiac arrest or whatever. Then when the CPR started, the person would magically turn into a mannequin. It was probably the funniest when this happened with a baby, and no, I'm not saying a baby going into cardiac arrest is funny, I'm just saying the video demonstration was funny. So the scene starts out with a woman talking on the phone, and the camera pans over to her baby who is playing on the floor in the living room. Then the camera cuts back to the woman, and she glances over to where her baby is playing. Suddenly her face gets this horrified expression as the camera zooms out to show that her baby has suddenly been turned into a mannequin. I guess it was so funny because with the adults, they could at least fake going through cardiac arrest. You couldn't get an 8-month-old baby to do that, so it was like, oh, the baby is playing, and then boom, mannequin. Maybe that's a problem in itself, babies that suddenly turn into plastic dolls and they need to do CPR in order to bring them back to being human. Anyways, I did get my certification, so I am capable of potentially saving someone's life. Pretty neat, right? Before I end this, I'd like to tell everyone about a Halloween art competition that I'm having in my Discord channel. The theme is retro Halloween, so basically anything 80s style and spooky. The submissions are due on the 25th, so you should still have time to make something if you'd like. There are a couple prizes for first and second place. First place gets a hand-drawn Halloween profile picture from me. Second place, a Steam code for a spooky game. If you'd like more details, just check out the announcements section of my Discord channel. I'll put a link to it in the description. Thanks everyone for watching and listening to me talk about Halloween and other stuff. Like I said before, this video will be split into two parts so I can recover before I make another over 20-minute voice recording. I think the next video should be about as long. Anyways, goodbye. I'll see you next time. Happy early Halloween. Anyway, thanks, bye.